This morning comes from Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. Two verses probably that sometimes we don't really think much about, but also is some verses that really we should consider. We read about the attitude or the feelings, if you will, of the Lord. Now we find in Genesis chapter 6, so this is not that far from the very beginning of time, really, from the beginning of creation, the beginning of everything. You'll notice in Genesis chapter 6, in verses 5 and 6, says, "Then the Lord saw the wickedness of man, that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart." Now, with that in mind, it's interesting for us to think about the idea of the Lord being sorry or the Lord being grieved in his heart. The King James uses the idea of being repented in his heart or grieved in his spirit. I want us to think this morning, I want to show the importance of the statement, "The Lord was sorry," what it means to us today. Have the actions or lifestyles of others ever caused you to worry about them, specifically about their spiritual state? Many of us may have friends or loved ones or co-workers who, because of the things they're involved in, we worry about their soul. We worry about what they're going to be doing or where their soul will be abiding when this life is over. Has God ever, or does he still today, have sorrow and worry over our choices in life as well? Now, sometimes it's kind of weird to think about the Lord worrying about us. But we consider that the Scripture refers to God as our Father or as a Heavenly Father numerous times throughout Scripture. And we know, of course, the goal of God and the goal of His Son coming and dying on the cross was to save mankind from their sins. It becomes very easy for us to understand that as a Father, of course, He would, as we see here in Genesis 5 and 6, perhaps worry or be hurt by the things that we do or the two things we choose to do in this life. So let's begin in Genesis chapter 6. We see that in Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and 6, beginning first at verse 5, the Bible says, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth." The Lord sees everything that we do in this life. And we have here also, as we'll look at here in just a few moments, the Lord doesn't just see our actions, but he also sees, as we see from the book of Hebrews, our thoughts and our intents of the heart. In Psalm 33, in verses 13 through 15, here the Bible says, "The Lord looks from heaven and sees all the sons of men. From the place of his dwelling he looks on all the inhabitants of the earth. He fashions their hearts individually. He considers all their works." Now with that in mind, that helps us remember that sometimes if we're not careful, we live our life as if no one's watching. We live our life as if that no one is seeing the things that we're doing or hearing the words that we're saying. You know, outside of this church building, many of us may not see one another throughout the week unless there's some kind of special event going on or unless we see each other again on Wednesday night. But you think about that in our mind, we have to remember that no matter who is around us physically, no matter who is calling us on the phone and talking with us or visiting with us, that the Lord is always, as we see here in the book of Psalms, looking down upon us, as he sees our actions. He knows all of our doings in this line. The Lord considers all the works of man, in verse 15. The Bible says he fashions their hearts individually. He considers all their works. Now think about the idea, he fashions their hearts individually. It's simply the idea there, he's looking at each one of us individually. He doesn't necessarily say, okay, well, this group of people here in the city of Oklahoma, they're mostly good people, so they're all going to heaven. No, he looks at each individual person. We see there in verse 15, he considers all their works. So with that in mind, we have to consider, when we think about how the Lord considers all of our works, we saw in Genesis 6 and verse 5, where it tells us the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in all the earth. Now, if you look at Hebrews chapter 4, and in verse 12, the Bible says, "For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and joints and marrow, and I notice, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart, which means the Lord knows the intents or the thoughts of our heart. He knows why we do things. He knows all things we're thinking in our mind. He knows also even our attitudes towards, whether it be people or persons or activities or whatever the case may be. He knows all those things. Now, with that in mind, the Lord sees wickedness. The Lord sees all, rather. Isn't it interesting, or isn't it obvious, of course, that much of what he sees is often wickedness? You think about for a moment, if you have the ability, because we can't enter the heavenly realm today unless we leave this line. Say perhaps you were a satellite in space, and we know there's probably thousands of them. They look down, they see all kinds of things. What if it looked down upon your life? What would it see? How would it see you acting every day? What if it could hear your speech? What if it could see your thoughts? You know, today we worry a lot about the government or Big Brother sometimes, we call him. You know, in reality, we should be worried a lot more about God, because no matter what the government does to us, we know that God's reactions and God's punishments are going to last forever. And we see in Genesis chapter 6, he says in verse 5, in Genesis 6 and verse 5, and that every tenth of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. The idea there is not that he's seeing people who are having bad ideas or bad thoughts or committing sins from time to time. He's saying their whole life was filled with sin. He even points out here that the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Now, of course, when he says he looked down the wickedness of man, he's not talking about just males. He's talking about mankind, male and female. He says that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually, meaning constantly dwelling upon evil things. Now, for us today, we may say, well, those people must have just been exceedingly wicked, you know, a level of wickedness we've never seen before. I'm not so sure that's true. Because if we look out in the world today, we know there are things going on, things that have taken place, things that may be taking place soon, that we would never dream would have happened before. As a child, I remember, I never thought much about the homosexual, because if someone came out and they were gay, most of the time what's going to happen is you're going to be, could be a beating, not that I can know those types of things, but there's going to be a reaction to it that's going to be, what, contrary to it, not one that's promoting a sinful lifestyle. I never thought of living in an age where we're having states and entire countries are saying it's okay to be into what they consider a marital union. And it's not a marital bond. A marital bond involves God, and such unions as homosexuals, although those things do not involve God. But we see here in verse 5, he says, the thoughts and the intents of his heart was only evil continually. You'll find about 38 times, if you're looking in the New King James, the phrase, did evil in the sight of the Lord in the Bible. And this should give us the idea of what God gets to see. This also helps us understand what the Lord said in Genesis 6 and verse 5. Well, the thoughts and intents of the heart, but the thoughts of man are only evil continually. And we think about that idea, if we see the phrase and phrases that are similar to the idea that they did evil in the sight of the Lord. Think about how many times you see those throughout the Bible. Not just they did evil in the sight of the Lord, but how many times you see phrases like, and they did what was right in their own eyes. Or they rebelled against God. All those types of phrases. How many times have you seen those in the Bible? Well, probably hundreds of times. Now notice, if you will, with me, Genesis chapter 6 and verse 6. Here the Bible says, the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Now the King James says here, when it says the Lord was sorry, the King James says it repented the Lord. Now obviously the Lord did not repent of some wrong that he had committed, as he cannot sin, he knows no sin. However, he can have a change of feelings towards his creation. Look at Genesis chapter 3. In Genesis chapter 3, in verses 23 and 24, and you'll excuse all the funky lineup. I'm not using my computer today. But you notice in verses 23 and 24, what the Bible says. In Genesis 3, beginning in verse 23, it says, therefore the Lord God sent him out, or Lord God sent him out of the garden. Garden meaning to till the ground from which he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden in a flaming sword which was toward every way to guard the way to the tree of life. In the very beginning, just a few, really, just maybe a chapter and a half or so before this, what was the Lord doing for man? He gave man a wife, he gave him Eve, he gave him the ability to tend a garden which he didn't have. You know, when you think about the life in the garden versus the life outside the garden, there was a completely different life. In the garden, your work was a very, very light load, you might say. Outside the garden, we read about he's going to till the ground and sow and reap by the sweat of his brow. So all of us, if you find, even back in the, during the very beginning towards the times of the creation account, that the feelings of man, or God towards man, had changed. Because we find in verse 23 and 24, he actually drove them out of the Garden of Eden, which he created just for them. He had to drive them out. Now, you notice in verse 24, he says, so he drove out the man. That means the man didn't just walk out, but God had to force him out. He drove out the man and placed cherubim in the east of the Garden of Eden in a flaming sword which turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. There was no going back, was there? There is no way to get back in to the Garden of Eden. There's no way to restore what they had once had with God. Their feelings have changed. That doesn't mean that Adam and Eve were not forgiven of their sins, but things have changed, haven't they? You think about that idea in Genesis chapter 6. Why did things change? Because the thoughts of man were only evil continually. We also saw in Genesis chapter 6, in verse 6, that the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth. Now, sorry does not mean that he had done something wrong, but that is, he had a change of feeling towards man. And why, how could you not have a change of feeling towards your creation when their thoughts or the intents of their heart were only evil continually? Now, with this in mind, the idea of the Lord being sorry, it may be possible that he was sorry or he repented to the Lord because of all the sin that man was now bringing into the world and all the sin that man was now engaged in. Because when man was created by God, he was without any sin. He was cared for by God, really a very pampered creation. Now, the second phrase we're going to look at here is in a grieved and grieving his spirit, Genesis 6 and verse 6. And he was grieved in his heart, or as King James says, grieved in his spirit. Now the word grieved in verse 6 can also be defined as to worry. And also includes the idea of being hurt. And we have here Strong's number 6087. That did that the sin of mankind didn't physically hurt God for us, but in a, we might say, almost in an inferior type of way, hurt him or caused him pain because of what they were doing. Now, with that in mind, you would say, well, how can sin hurt God? How is it that God was sorry he created man? How was he grieved in his spirit? What does all that mean? And why would he be sorry or worry or have hurt in his heart because of the actions of man? Isaiah 59 and verse 2. But your iniquities have separated you from your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. That is why I think that's a good way to explain the feelings of God in Genesis chapter 6. His actions or his feelings towards man had changed, and that man was involved in sin that, if not repented of, would separate man from God for all eternity. You'll notice there in Isaiah 59 and verse 2, it says, your iniquities have separated you from your God. Now, iniquities, sins, transgressions, all those things refer to sin of mankind. And your sins have hidden his face from you. Now, if God wants the best for mankind, wants him to have eternal life, well, isn't it true the last thing that God wants is to have his face hidden from him, from you? So have your face hidden from God is the opposite of what God wants. He says your sins have hidden his face from you. Well, we go back to Genesis 6, verse 5. What was the thoughts and intents of man continually? Only sinful. So if sin separates man from God, we see here in Isaiah, if sin causes man not to be able to see the face of God, it's no wonder God said, the Lord said he was sorry and grieved in his heart because mankind was separating themselves from him. They were separating themselves also from the hope of eternal life. Does worry and hurt over sin still exist today? When man sins, he has the risk of being separated from God forever. That is, he has the risk to be eternally separated from God, never returning. As you see there in Isaiah 59, what's going to happen if they, what happens with our sin that separates us from God so that he will not hear us or hear our prayers? But also we see in Matthew chapter 25, in verse 46, says, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Well, who are those who are going away into everlasting punishment? Those who are what? Those who have their life filled with sin, who have never turned away from those things. Those who have sinned life and refuse to repent. Those who refuse to acknowledge their actions or even sin at all will face the possibility, if they will not change, of having everlasting punishment. Now, it's interesting sometimes when we talk about the eternal life, what we have to help people remember is that everyone has an eternal life. The problem is, or the question is, which place do you want to spend it? And as we notice in verse 46, both are described as being everlasting or eternal. Everlasting punishment, meaning without end. There is no ending to it. It has no beginning. It has no end. Christ gives us several accounts in the book of Matthew. He talks about where the flame is never quenched, the worm dieth not, means it never stops. But the righteous into eternal life, which means the blessings, the relief, the rest that we have in eternal life, it never stops either. It lasts for all eternity. It too is everlasting. Is it possible to hurt God today, or to still hurt God today by our sins? Now, when I use that phrase, hurt God, I know our denominational friends sometimes use this in a way that I would not intend to. When we say hurt God, we mean that it hurts him or offends him or makes him sorrowful because it can separate us from him eternally if it's not dealt with. We look at Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 through 6. Here the Bible says, he says, for it is possible for those who were once enlightened, that is, once were faithful, and have tasted the heavenly gift, and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit, all referring to those who are faithful followers of God, and have tasted the good word of God, and the power of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God, and put him to an open shame. Now the phrase I want us to think about there is the phrase an open shame. Now when you think about for a second, if you're out in the store with your son or with your daughters or grandchildren or maybe, and they begin acting up, sometimes what happens? They kind of embarrass you, don't they? They don't really make you shameful, they embarrass you. Now if they act out too badly, they will become shameful in some ways. When you think about that idea, isn't it true that since we are called the sons of God, sons and daughters of God, as being faithful Christians, that when we sin and do not repent of those things and refuse to come back to obey God, that we also bring shame upon God as well? He says here in verse 6, and put him to an open shame. Because the only thing worse than a person who has never come to Christ is a person who has come to Christ and then left. In fact, the Bible tells us, he says, for those who have tasted the heavenly gift or have become faithful and go back in the world, he says, it's better than what? They've never been born. Because when you think about in the eyes of God, the eyes of the apostles and talking to there, how can anyone who have come to God and become obedient find something that would pull them away and never allow them to come back? You'll notice here in Hebrews chapter 6, In verse 6, he says, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God. Now that phrase there has the idea that as if God's Son is going to be crucified again. That doesn't mean that Christ, of course, is going to be crucified again on the cross. But we're doing what? We run the risk of having ourselves separated from God, and our sins, what? They need to be taken care of. And when we repent of our sins, whether it be through prayer or as a first time coming to God and through obedience and being baptized, what is it that washes away our sin? What's the blood of Christ? If His mission, if God's mission is to redeem us from sin, it makes sense that when we do sin, it causes Him to worry and to be possibly hurt by it, much like an earthly father would be as well. Just like a mother or father, when their children act up or when they do something they know they're not supposed to do, not only are we upset, but we're kind of hurt by it, or we're kind of offended that they didn't obey us. Because we're not trying to be cruel to them, we're trying to do what? Keep them out of harm's way, keep them out of additional trouble, teach them manners or whatever the case may be. So sometimes it's not just that we're irritated by it, but we're hurt by the things they have chosen to do by them disobeying us. Well, the Heavenly Father may not be any different as well. Worry and hurt over sin still exists today, and those who refuse to turn from their sin will face a certain fearful expectation. If you've seen Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 and 27. Hebrews 10, verses 26 and 27. Here the Bible says, for if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sin, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and a fire indignation which will devour the adversaries. Now you think about that idea. If we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there not remains a sacrifice for sins. That means what? It means we need to take care of that sin. It means we need to repent of those things so that we can have the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, His blood removing our sins for us. He says in verse 27, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and a fiery indignation which devour the adversary. Now, obviously, this verse cannot be teaching. We cannot repent when we have known the truth and committed sin. He's not saying that we cannot repent of it because the Bible teaches otherwise. So, obviously, he's talking about those who swiftly sin and willfully remain in sin and refuse to change their ways. Well, what happens? He says here, by a certain fearful expectation, he's talking about they're going to lose their eternal soul if they do not change. He says here in verse 27, notice that he uses the phrase, a certain fearful expectation. They should expect that when this life is over, they haven't changed their ways, they're going to be in a bad situation. We see there in verse 27, and fiery indignation which will devour the adversaries. Much like parents who worry about their children, our Heavenly Father, like our earthly parents, wants us to avoid the pain and punishment that comes with sin. Now, it shouldn't be hard for us to understand the correlation between our Heavenly Father and our earthly Father as well, because both should want the best for us. And since our God, what the Bible is referred to as the Heavenly Father many times, we can see that His actions and our response to Him should be much the same. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, here the Bible tells us in Romans 6 and verse 23, says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. For the wages of sin is death. Now, what is it that our Heavenly Father wants us to avoid? Well, He wants us to avoid that wage, that price that sin puts on our heads. If you go out today and you break the law, if you are driving on the road, you break the speed limit and a police officer catches you, unlike the police, God always catches you when you're sinning. But if He catches you and He pulls you over and He gives you a ticket and says, here is what? Here's your ticket. He might even be able to tell you the amount. He's giving you what? The wage for your transgression of the law. Well, for us today, for Christians, when we transgress God's law, if we not take care of it, the wages of our sin is death. But the gift of God, it is the sacrifice of God, of His Son on the cross is what? Eternal life to those who are obedient to Him, as the book of Hebrews also tells us. To avoid damnation and to not cause others to worry over our spiritual condition, we must avoid sin and sinful situations. Now, you think about that for a moment. We go back to Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. Why was it the Bible tells us that the Lord was sorry He had created man, that He was grieved in His spirit? Why was He? Why does the Bible record those words for us? To let us know that the Lord was what? Sorrowful over the things that those individuals were doing. And for us today, we can expect the same thing. He's not going to be thrilled about us committing sin as well. It's hard to believe that a New Testament Christian would want to cause our Heavenly Father sorrow or hurt by seeing the lifestyle of sin you may be involved in. Now you think about that for a moment. Our Heavenly Father, who sent His Son to die on the cross for all mankind so that His blood can remove our sins, the sins of the obedient. The last thing He wants to happen is for us to not receive eternal life. In John 3, verse 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." Should not perish tells us that there's still a possibility we can perish, because just because Christ died on the cross does not mean we'll have eternal life. We have to be what? We have to put into action, the obedient action of putting our faith in God and in Christ and coming and following after Him. In order to avoid sin and avoid causing further pain to our Heavenly Father, causing him not say worry or grief, we have to avoid and repent of any sin to be obedient to His Word. Now, with that in mind, what about you today? Are we involved in things? Are you involved in things that are going to cause someone pain? You know, just like when we say something sometimes and we realize, there, I shouldn't have said that. That was offensive. That was rude. And we go back and we apologize for that, or maybe we do something, or whatever the case may be. Our Heavenly Father also wants us to realize that our sins will cause Him pain as well. As we see there in Genesis 6, verses 5 and 6, the Lord was sorry that He had created man. He had grief in His heart over the actions and the sins of mankind. And we know that because we go back to Genesis chapter 6, and you look at the following verses, the Bible tells us what happens not soon after that. The Bible tells us that God told Noah to prepare an ark because He's going to do what? He's going to take care of that problem right now. And just like that today as well, we don't repent of our sin. When it comes to the end of our life, we too will have our sins dealt with, and we'll have our lives judged before God. So the question we have to ask is, do we want to cause God grief or worry by the lifestyle we are living, or by the actions that we are involved in? Because the last thing we want to do is cause anyone grief or heartache over our spiritual condition, and we certainly don't want to cause God sorrow over our actions either. This morning, if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, if you will repent of your sins, confess Christ as being the Son of God, be immersed in baptism where your sins are washed away and you're placed in the body of Christ, we've seen Galatians 3, verses 26 and 27, and then when you are told to remain faithful unto death, Revelation 2, verse 10, so that when Christ comes back, we will be called one of His faithful and enter into that heavenly home. We do know, however, as Christians, that sometimes we do make mistakes. We say things, we do things, perhaps we overreact to a situation, but the case may be we cause sin into our lives. We can take care of those things at any time, and today we can do so as well this morning. If you have any needs or concerns, you can come forward now. That's going to be saying, singing to encourage you.